For more than 35 years, a small but mighty program based out of Waterloo, Ontario, has turned summer holidays for some of Canada's best and brightest youth into an opportunity to enrich both the high school students and the world. Tim Jackson is president and CEO of SHAD, and he joins us now to tell us about the program. Welcome.
Thank you very much for having
me. It's very nice to have you here. So according to your website, this is what SHAD is. SHAD is a registered Canadian charity that empowers exceptional high school students at a pivotal point in their education to recognize their capabilities and envision their extraordinary potential as tomorrow's leaders and change makers. Where were you when I was in high school?
Yeah, well, that's where Canada's best kept secret, so many people say that to us.
Why don't more people know about SHAD?
Well, I think for the last 35 years, SHAD has just gone about its business and taken some of the brightest and best students from across the country, but hasn't told its story. And so now what we're trying to do is say we have an incredible track record. The students that have attended the program talk about it in the context of being life-changing and transformational. So our goal now is to say, let's make sure all Canadian students are aware of the program and have the opportunity to participate if they want to.
Where does the name SHAD come from?
Well, it goes way back to the foundings of the organization. Mm-hmm. It was started by a teacher in Aurora, Ontario, worked at a school, and through the school's yards was a creek called Shad Creek. Shad is a type of fish. Mm-hmm. He decided to start the program and said, well, rather than call it Shad Creek, I'm going to call it Shad Valley, and the rest is history. It used to be called Shad Valley International, and mm-hmm. now we've just shortened it to Shad.
And why high school students?
Well, I think that's the pivotal point in their growth, that we take grade 10, 11, and 12 high school students. Mm-hmm. And we say, if you can empower those students at that point in their lives, and if you can say, there are other like-minded students like you, and if we can give them the tools to experiment, to innovate, to be creative, then they can go on to do great things. So it's really at that pivotal point where they're trying to decide what are they going to do in the future.
And how do you do this? How do you turn these exceptional students into leaders?
Well, it's really a three-pronged approach. They start with the month of July. We take 800 students, and they travel to 13 universities across the country mm-hmm. in groups of about 60. And they spend the month of July together, living in residence, working 7/24, and they get exposed to university faculty who will do lectures. Business leaders, community leaders come in from the community to talk to them. And they're given a real world problem to solve, a social issue. And so over the course of the month, they're learning, but they're also prototyping, they're experimenting, they're innovative, they're failing. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the month, they come up with a solution to that real world problem. And so you start with the summer program, and then we offer an internship where they can get real life work experience.
So they can work at different organizations?
Exactly. And we'll work in their home community or remotely. Mm-hmm. So they get some real experience in the workforce. And then once they're done, they now join 16,000 other SHADs. We call them SHAD fellows. Mm-hmm. And they're part of a lifelong network. So whether they need mentors, whether they need someone to help them with their business idea, whether they need someone just to talk to who's got some experience, they're now part of that network for life. So it's really a three-pronged approach to the SHAD family.
And is it hard to convince students to give up part of their summer to do this?
Well, I would have thought it would be, but it's actually incredible. Our applications the last 3 years have been record highs. Mm-hmm. We have a massive wait list, so we'd love to expand the program. And much like the premise of your question, when I first started, I thought, well, what grade 10, 11, 12 student wants to spend mm-hmm. half of their summer in school in a certain way? But the students that come to SHAD, they're curious, they love being challenged. So no, it's an easy sell is the answer.
I mean, it sounds great. It sounds expensive. Yeah. How do students apply for this?
So they apply without regard to financial means. So we do the application process. We then select the students to attend the program. They are given an offer to attend. And then we ask them, do you need financial assistance? So our goal is to ensure that no student is unable to attend because they don't have the financial means. So we raise money mm-hmm. Through a bursary program, a combination of governments, private donors, philanthropists themselves, foundations, sponsors, who help ensure that students who can't afford the fee to attend are able to attend it. So students pay anywhere from nothing to the full cost of the program.
Now, if, I think the idea is to get the best and brightest minds in the country. Mm-hmm. If you don't know about the program, are you going to go look for some of these students?
Yeah, that's part of the challenge. It's been a great secret. Mm-hmm. Most of our students have come through word of mouth, through friends that have been in the program, family members. Mm-hmm. So we're really working to say we need to increase our outreach efforts. While we have a huge wait list, we'd like to make sure that everyone is aware of it. So particularly things like rural remote students, mm-hmm. students from Indigenous communities, So we're working with partners. So we just, earlier this year, signed an agreement with Pathways to Education, where Pathways to Education will identify students in their programs and get them admitted into SHAD. So we won't do it all ourselves. We'll find people who are in some of those communities, and they'll tell us who should be a SHAD.
Now, why do students who are already excelling need a program like SHAD?
I think it does a couple of things. First off, it brings them into that network and allows them to realize there are other students like me across the country. Last summer when I was at the program, there was a young woman from Portage La Prairie who said to me, she said, Tim, there is nowhere for me to do science, math, engineering, enrichment in my community. So that's the first bit. For many people, it's the only opportunity they have to do this type of enrichment. Mm-hmm. But the second is they're together with like-minded people. If you're from a small, rural, remote community, you may not realize that there are other people across the country your age that are interested in science, math, engineering.
And what are your hopes for the program moving forward?
So we'd like to expand it. We'd like to have the goal is very simple, that every Canadian student who should be in SHAD is given the opportunity. Mm-hmm. So to do that, we have to do three things. One, we need to make more people aware of it. Mm-hmm. Two, we need to make sure it's affordable, so increase our bursaries. And three, we need to have places for them. So you're gonna see us over the next few years expand the program to more than our current 13 campuses.
And maybe a mature students division down the line.
I think there's all sorts
raising
of opportunities.
My hand.
Mature students, international opportunities. Imagine SHAD at MIT or SHAD at Oxford, SHAD at Canterbury. So I think the sky's the limit for us in the future.
Tim, thank you so much for being here. I'm really glad that more people are going to know about SHAD.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Next up, we're going to talk to two graduates of the SHAD program. But first, let's look at some numbers. The SHAD program hosts more than 700 Canadian students each year at 13 participating universities, including the University of British Columbia, Memorial University of Newfoundland, and seven Ontario schools. Since its inception in 1980, SHAD has taught more than 16,000 students, and 32 of those students have gone on to be named Rhodes Scholars, widely regarded as the world's most prestigious scholarship. And joining us now for a student perspective, two SHAD grads, Rudy Jarvis, a 2016 SHAD graduate from Keswick, Ontario, going into grade 12 in September at Sacred Heart Catholic School. And Simone Cavanaugh, 2011 SHAD grad, recently graduated from McGill University's Law School and a member of the Prime Minister's Youth Council. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Wow, I was just saying, when I was your age, I wasn't doing anything this cool. So
yeah.
Well done to both of you.
Thank you.
Rudy, how did you find out about SHAD?
Originally, it came down to my grade 6 teacher. I was babysitting for her in 2015, and she just offhandedly mentioned that her cousins went to the program and that I should check it out, and so I did.
So why did you? What drew you to it?
I was looking for things kind of to do over the summer. I didn't really have much planned.
You don't want to go to the pool and hang out?
Well, I mean, it's always nice, but, you know, if you can do that in Saskatchewan, then why not? But yeah, she just mentioned it to me and I did a little bit of research and then I found that it was a really interesting program, so I figured why not apply.
And Simone, what were your expectations going into the program?
I had no idea what to expect. Mm-hmm. I went to SHAD Laval, so in Quebec City, not that far away from Montreal where I was. Mm-hmm. And you know, I was just looking forward to a change of pace. I really wanted to switch things up. And boy, am I ever glad that I went.
Did the experience meet your expectations?
Yeah, well, I really had no idea what I was getting into at all. I'd been involved in sciences in the past, but I also was really interested in a lot beyond that. Mm-hmm. And it definitely exceeded any expectations I did have.
And why is education something that's important to you?
I mean, education is so important in every way. I'm a law graduate from McGill University, and a lot of what I do in my human rights work is just educating people on the world around them and understanding their rights, and just having the opportunity like SHAD to be exposed to so many things that a lot of young people don't get access to. Mm-hmm. Has been amazing. It opens up doors. So it's giving people access to these opportunities that makes a difference.
And Rudy, what's been your experience with SHAD?
My experience was generally the same as Simone's. Mm-hmm. It was kind of, I went into it, I didn't really know what to expect. I'd done a little bit of research. I knew that we were going to be working on something. Mm-hmm. But other than that, there wasn't a whole lot that I knew about it. And so going into it was a fresh new thing. Mm-hmm. I was brought halfway across the country into a brand new school, brand new place I'd never seen before. Mm-hmm. And I was thrown in with 55 other like-minded students, and I became some of the best friends with them.
And you were one of the youngest ones there, too.
I was one of the youngest ones, yeah. I was one of, I think, five or six people, mm-hmm. five or six students in grade 10. Everybody else was grade 11 or graduating.
I'm guessing, when you're put in that kind of situation, you can either sink or swim. What did you learn about yourself when you did that?
I learned a little bit that I was a stronger leader than I had thought. When I was put into the group to work on the project, because there is a project associated with it, they give you a problem.
Which problem did you have?
We were given the problem of solving food security in Canada. Mm-hmm. And so when you're put into a group in that situation, it really comes down to how well your group can collaborate and how cohesive it is to work together with one another. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes down to that, somebody kind of has to step up as the leader to make sure that, you know, everybody's heard. Mm-hmm. And so I felt that it really revealed to me that that was my role in the group. And so I tried to mediate in my group, you know, make sure everybody's heard, make sure all the ideas are out there so we have the best chance of finding what we can really work with.
And you received a leadership award, right?
Yeah, I received the David Black Award for Excellence in Leadership.
Were you surprised by that?
I was very surprised. I had no idea. I didn't even plan to go to the SHAD Cup for the award ceremony. And then my grandma was like, yeah, no, like, we're going to go because, you know, somebody's going to drive us down. Uh-huh. And so we ended up going, and I ended up winning it. And it was a fantastic surprise.
Did you wear running shoes that night? Because we were just talking about running shoes and how comfortable they are. But you wore good shoes that night.
I did wear good shoes. I wore these exact shoes, actually.
And Simone, what was the theme in 2011 when you were at SHAD?
So it was providing solutions for families with children with disabilities, mm-hmm. actually, which aligns very well with what I do. Mm-hmm. And my team developed a stimulation board for kids with developmental disabilities. We didn't win, but we did a really great job in coming together and making sure everyone was heard. It was an amazing experience.
Yeah. How did you divide the teams?
So I think we were just sort of let loose and to agglomerate together. Mm-hmm. And then within that team, it was like, how do we divide the work between each other? Mm-hmm. And you're in such an incubator, right? You're living, sleeping, breathing together in the same space for a month. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty hard to separate everything else from the project. Mm-hmm. But one thing that was amazing being at SHAD, unlike being in a regular school context, everyone is a leader. Everyone really wants to get things done. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot easier to, you know, have performing team members. It's just sort of sectioning off who's going to be a leader in what sense, what kind of leader. Yeah.
And your idea sprung from real life experiences for you. Mm-hmm. What was life like for you growing up?
So I have juvenile arthritis, and I spent 7 years of my childhood in a wheelchair because of it, because of the chronic pain of the disease. And so over the course of my life, I've just lived with chronic pain a lot, and I'm a lot better now due to medications, but I have the side effect of being immunosuppressed, so I get infections left, right, and center. So that's been tricky, but mm-hmm. I, from that experience, from being a child with a disability, I've worked a lot. All my jobs have revolved around disability in my early years, and then I became quite an advocate as a spokesperson for the Arthritis Society and founded a nonprofit organization that works with kids with disabilities in Nicaragua.
And I was watching your TED Talk where you spoke about going to Nicaragua and meeting a young boy who we will call Diego. How did that experience change your outlook on life?
It changed everything drastically. I think it was one of those moments that everyone hopes to have in their life or at some point that, you know, seeking that meaning, but mm-hmm. it just really fell in my lap, quite literally, actually. We were all assigned different houses in this small village. It was just a school trip. And I happened to be placed in the home of a woman, Doña Nora, and her grandson has cerebral palsy. And he was the only child in the village ever to have a disability. Mm-hmm. So fate, or whatever you want to call it, I fell in love with him. And I just couldn't imagine how I could leave there knowing that he spent most of his days lying in bed, not interacting with the world around him, not playing with his friends, when I had had so many opportunities, and what it would have been like if I had been born in Nicaragua.
So you did what?
So, well, I spent a year fundraising and got him a wheelchair, walker, and some adapted equipment, mm-hmm. brought back an occupational therapist to work with him and his family, and that was the start of our nonprofit organization, Pivot International, and since then we've helped dozens of kids like Diego.
And you did all that before the age of what?
I guess 19, was
it? See, this is what I hear there's people say so many negative things about younger people, but I can't believe I use the term younger people. I am officially old. But but it's like you're both doing really great things. And how do you hope that your experiences with SHAD will, I guess, help you to help other kids? Rudy?
I think that using the experience from SHAD, using all the new things that you learn, all the skills that you develop and things like that, mm-hmm. You can really bring them back into your own school environment. Because it is such a drastically different environment. You go from this high-end group of people that you're all in the same mind space, right? You're all mm-hmm. looking to work towards all this. And then you come back to your high school and things are different. It might not be like as high-end as that. Mm-hmm. And so coming back to that, you can really bring all the things from SHAD and adapt it to your high school or your school or wherever you mm-hmm. are. And you can put those skills to use and really focus on making it better.
And Rudy, you're going to be heading into your final high school year.
Yes.
What are your thoughts about what you will do after you finish school,
after
you graduate?
After I graduate?
Yeah.
Right now, I'm looking to go to University of Waterloo for nanotechnology engineering.
Wow, what's that?
working with the really, really small of science. So 1 nanometer is 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter, mm-hmm. and it's working with things of the scale from 100 to 500 nanometers. And so it's 100 to 500 billionths of a meter.
Wow.
So it's very, very small things, and there's so many things that you can do with it. It's a really up-and-coming field. I don't think there's a lot of attention on it right now, mm-hmm. although I'm hoping that it'll get a lot bigger in the future and because of all the applications for it.
Now, both of your parents have passed on,
yes.
and I know education was really important to your dad. What would your parents say if they could see you now and all that you've accomplished?
I can really only go by what my grandma tells me, and mm-hmm. that's that they would be very, very proud of me.
And how about you? How do you feel about yourself?
I'm pretty happy with where I'm at right now. Mm-hmm. Even if it's not in the best of, you know, living situations mm-hmm. or like not necessarily the best everything that I can have, I'm happy with it because I still get all the chances that I need and all the opportunities that I can because of programs like SHAD.
And you're moving forward, right?
Absolutely.
Always move forward.
Always move forward.
Yeah.
Just keep swimming.
Exactly. And Simone, tell us about the work you're doing with the Prime Minister's Youth Council.
Yeah, so I sit on the Prime Minister's Youth Council, which is a group of 26 young people from several thousand of us that applied for this position. And I advise the Prime Minister and a lot of federal cabinet ministers on issues pertaining to youth, so particularly young women in Canada. I can only speak to, you know, my experience and young people with disabilities. So I'm always pushing those two angles. And what's been really exciting to see is that the government seems to be listening. Mm-hmm. It seems to be a genuine interest, especially on behalf of the Prime Minister and ministers, to really engage with young people. Mm-hmm. And as I'm sure you all know, innovation is a big number one on the agenda. So I just find that SHAD is an amazing fit for what the Youth Council and what Canada is moving towards, young people and innovation, the perfect combination of both of those.
And have you met the Prime Minister?
Yeah, a few times.
And
yeah.
Was he nice? Was he?
He's nice, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so I always describe him. He was a teacher. Mm-hmm. You can tell that he was a teacher. It's kind of like we're the Prime Minister's class, but instead of him teaching us, we're teaching him. And he's a very good listener, in our presence at least. So it's been a really cool experience.
Now, Rudy, when you went back to school after you were at SHAD, what was the experience like going back to like a regular school after spending that summer?
Well, like I said before, it's really a different environment. Mm-hmm. And going there, it's surreal because it's this completely different environment. You have no idea really what you're getting, at least in my experience and from what I know Simone's. You really don't know what you're getting into at that mm-hmm. point. Coming back, it's a little bit different because you know what's coming. You know that, okay, it's gonna be school again, back to all my friends, all my teachers that I know. And so...
Does it give you like a better perspective on life after school?
Yeah. It really preps you for all those things because of a lot of the things that they teach you, like business, entrepreneurship, investing, stuff like that. It really preps you for life after high school. Mm-hmm. And then moving back to high school from SHAD, like I said, you really just pull all of the skills and applications and stuff that you now have from SHAD, and you can apply them in your school environment.
Now, if somebody's watching, a student is watching, what advice would you give them about applying to the program?
I would say that do it 100%. If you apply, then you have the chance. If you don't get in, you can apply again, or you can look for other things to do. Mm-hmm. But if you do get in, it's the opportunity of a lifetime, absolutely. And if you do end up applying, there's really three things that they look at.
What?
Of course, there's the marks, because in an intense situation like this, you have to have an aptitude for certain things. Mm-hmm. But it's not only that. They look at character, who you are as a person, what kind of things you do in your community.
Community work and stuff?
Community work, volunteer work. Yeah. They look at a lot of school extracurriculars if you have them. Mm-hmm. And then...
is it more like a leadership, like how
you get along with
people?
Yeah, that's what it was. It's a leadership standpoint.
Yeah.
So they really look at what you can do as a person and what you bring to a team.
And Simone, anything to add to that?
I mean, absolutely apply. People always say to me, like what you were saying, like, oh, it's amazing, you've done so many things. I've applied to way more things than I've ever gotten accepted into. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, don't dwell on the ones I didn't get accepted for. And I think you can't get anywhere without putting yourself out there, and it's scary, and it's intimidating, but it's worth the step, because even if one door doesn't open fully, it'll lead to a different one, and opportunities present themselves that way. So absolutely, just go for it.
And what aspect of your SHAD experience would you say has had the greatest impact on you?
I would say there are two main things. So the first one was being in a room full of leaders for the first time. That was the first, not the last time that I was in a room full of overachievers that really were ready to get something done. Mm-hmm. And I learned to adapt in a room like that, and how do we make sure there's room for everyone and benefit from everybody's voice as much as possible when people have a lot to say. Mm-hmm. So that was an amazing part. And then the second was just the support of the network has been incredible. When I was at SHAD, I mean, I was still, and I still am, struggling with my arthritis a lot during that month. And the support I had from my other SHAD fellows was unbelievable. So it's that, those types of networks of people that really believe in each other and know that we're going far, that are worthwhile.
What's next in schooling for you?
Well, I just finished law school at McGill.
You originally wanted to be a doctor, right?
Yeah, I did.
So why did you switch to law?
So, well, actually, in the midst of my SEJEP years, so in Quebec we have a bit of a different system.
That's like grade 11 or grade 12?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I actually had a relapse and in my condition, and I realized, because I really wanted to work internationally and in development, I'm not going to be very good to my patients if I'm more sick than them most of the time. So I had to sort of sit back and think about that reality and then think
about...
Was
that heartbreaking though for you?
It was hard. It was hard because I really thought I could do it. Mm-hmm. And I still think I could have done it. And that's not... I moved beyond that. And the question was, okay, so what was the point? Why did I want to be a pediatrician in developing countries? What was it about that? And it was to make the world a better place, to alleviate suffering, especially in children. And so I decided to take the route of human rights, of law, and focus on international human rights and development. And so it's the same principle, alleviating suffering, just using different tools. So hopefully that'll work.
Rudy, I know you're going to school and you want to go to Waterloo for nanotechnology. Mm-hmm. But moving forward, what are your plans for developing your leadership skills?
Moving forward, I think I'm really looking to find more opportunities to apply that or build on that even. Mm-hmm. Really just throughout my community, where I live right now, or any places that I travel, really, any places that I go to live. Maybe even when I go to university, look for things to do there that I can...
What interests you?
Really, science, technology, things like that. Yeah.
And Simone, for you?
Well, I'm hoping to take the skills that I've acquired in law school and studying human rights and through my advocacy and bring it internationally. So right now, the next year, I'll be doing a fellowship called the Ocean Path Fellowship, which is a project-based fellowship. And I'm working on a specific project with parents of kids with disabilities in Nicaragua, teaching them the human rights framework and how to defend the rights of their children. And then hopefully, well, I'll have my first introduction to the UN this summer. So I'll be involved with the Canadian delegation for the convention on the UN States Party to the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. So this is like a dream come true for me. And hopefully that will launch the next steps of my career.
Well, congratulations. And are you going to, how long are you going to live in Nicaragua?
So it'll be over the next year. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, like back and forth, but yeah.
So would either one of you run for prime minister down the line?
Maybe, we'll see.
I don't think so, I don't think that's
why not?
You never know.
You never know. Yeah. You never know. I can't see it in my future personally. I'm more of a science, technology, engineering person.
So is the current prime minister.
That's true. That's true. Although, you never know.
And you've got the same hair. Yeah. Rudy and Simone, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having us.
And congratulations on all your success. We'll be looking for you in the future.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Help TVO create a better world through the power of learning. Visit TVO.org and make a tax-deductible donation today.